caution you, those of you who may be used to taking notes may find it helpful. Those of you who don't necessarily take a lot of notes in matters may find it distracting. It's totally up to you whether or not you take notes. No one is going to look at your notes any time. You will have to leave your notebooks here only evenings during lunch, but you will have them available to you during deliberations. After that, your notebooks will be picked up and destroyed. Again, as I told you, nobody's going to do it. So it's entirely up to you. The idea is to try and make it as easy and as helpful to you to get the information during the trial. And you make your own judgment as to how you do that. Mr. Hammerin?
Thank you, Your Honor. The state would call Daniel Koster to the stand. Please introduce yourself to the jury.
My name is Daniel Koster. That's Mark Koster.
Mr. Koster, if you could slide your chair forward a little bit, please. Thank you. There's that microphone, you can bend it a little bit closer. Thanks. For the record, would you spell your last name?
K-O-S-P-E-R.
Where do you currently live, Mr. Koster?
I live in Nampa, Idaho.
How long have you lived there?
I've been out there about a year and a half now.
Are you currently employed?
Yes.
What do you do?
I drive semi for EV drivers.
Prior to moving to Idaho, where did you live?
I lived in Wall Lake, and before that I lived in Auburn, Iowa.
And about how long did you live in those areas?
I lived in Wall Lake for about a year, and then I lived in Auburn on and off for about 6 or 7 years.
Were you employed during those times?
Yes, I was driving semi for several different companies.
Where were you born?
Osage, Iowa.
And who are your parents?
Edgar and Dolores Koster.
Is your mother still living?
No, she passed away in 2000.
And how about your father, Edgar?
He's just turned 93 back in September.
How's his health?
He has diabetes and he takes insulin for that, but he has dementia pretty bad.
How many brothers and sisters did you have growing up?
I had 5 brothers and 5 sisters.
It was one of your brothers, Mark Koster?
Yes.
Where are you in the range of 11 siblings? Are you in the middle or are you?
I'm in the second half.
And how about Mark Koster? Was he older than or younger than you?
He was the second oldest.
How many years older was Mark than you?
About 9.
And when was Are all your siblings still alive?
No, my oldest brother Pat died in 1988 from Agent Orange. He got cancer. And just this past February, my sister Christy, that was like 15 months older than me, she just passed away in February of this year.
Where are all your brothers and sisters now? Do they live out of the state of Iowa?
Yes, there's none of them that live in Iowa currently.
And when you were growing up, did you all grow up in the St. Ansgar area?
Well, the first six that were born actually grew up in central Iowa over by Breda, Auburn area. And then they moved up to Stacyville, where we lived up there on the farm.
Where did your brother Mark go to high school?
He went to St. Ansgar.
And did he graduate from high school?
Yes.
Where did he do after high school?
He joined the Marine Corps, because my brother Pat was in the Marine Corps, so he went and joined a couple months after Pat did.
And then after Mark got out of the Marine Corps, do you know what he did?
He went to computer school to be a computer programmer.
What kind of guy was Mark?
He was a pretty friendly guy. He liked to fish, and he liked to play cards, and he liked to argue, and, you know.
Did your brother Mark, did he like to be around a lot of people, or was he more of a person that wanted to be by himself?
Well, he liked to spend a lot of time by himself, too, but he did help, you know, when we had family get-togethers or when he went to work. He was always around with people that he worked with and stuff.
How would you describe your brother Mark as a worker?
Well, he was a hard worker.
After he went to school for a while, did he have jobs in various states?
Yeah, all of our family members have lived in one state other than my sister Christy that passed away. She was the only one that stayed in the state of Iowa her whole life.
And how about a size-wise, let's say toward 2009, at that time period, how tall was Mark?
He'd be about the same size as me, about 5'10 and a half as far as tall. About the same way, because we could switch clothes if we wanted to.
And do you remember in 2009, approximately how much Mark would weigh?
I'd say maybe 140 pounds.
May I approach the witness, Your Honor?
Yes.
Mr. Koster, I handed you a photograph, State Exhibit Number 2. Do you recognize who's in the picture?
Yes, my brother Mark.
The state would offer into evidence State's Exhibit Number 2.
No objection.
2 as you speak. Permission to publish, Your Honor?
Yes.
Mr. Koster, did your brother, when this picture was taken, do you know what state it was in?
I'm not sure. Can't recognize the driveway.
Did your at one point did your brother Mark live in Texas?
Yeah.
Do you know what he was doing in Texas?
Well, me and him, both of us worked at this back.
And when in the 1980s did your brother Mark work there?
That was like the beginning of the 1980s. It was like March 1980 when I went down there. He went down there maybe a month or so before I did.
And about how long did you both work down there?
Well, we stayed in that area for about 2 to 3 years, and then I moved to Arkansas.
To your knowledge, did your brother Mark stay in Texas for a while?
Not then. He went out for like a week. He went out to California for a while to get a bunch of money saved up, and eventually he did come to Arkansas for a while.
Did your brother at some point move Mark back to Texas?
Yes, in the middle 80s, he went back down to Dallas, Fort area.
And did you know where he was working in the middle 80s?
Yeah, he's working at a Circle K, and then he went to a mobile gas station. I don't know how many other different stores that he worked at.
And did you go down to visit your brother Mark?
Yeah, because I had my sister, one of my sisters lived there, and a couple of my brothers lived there, so we'd get together for Christmas or Thanksgiving and have a get together with them, so I went down to visit a few times.
And when you were down visiting Mark in the middle of the 1980s, did you know at that time the defendant John David Green?
Yes, I met him at the convenience store.
I think, sir, you're going to have to speak a little bit. I can tell some of the jurors are having some difficulty.
Okay, I met this John Green down there because he was Mark's manager at one of these stores.
And when you saw your brother in the middle of the 1980s, did everything appear to be going okay with him?
Yeah, he was saving his money up like he always did. And he had his car, and you know, he seemed fairly happy.
Was there a pattern with your brother, Mark? You talk about saving money up. Would he save money up for any particular reason, or what would he do?
Well, he got into buying stock and stuff like that, too. So, you know, he'd save up money and buy stock, and then if he made some money off of it, then he'd sell it. But, you know, he just kept working, and then sometimes he'd stop working for a while. But he'd work 2-3 years, and then he might take 6 months off. But he had the money.
And then after 6 months, would he go back to working?
Right. Anytime he felt like he was getting low on money, he'd go back to work.
At some point, to your knowledge, did your brother Mark move from Texas to Florida?
Yeah, 1988 had been the spring of 88. He had moved down to Ocala, Florida.
And I forgot to ask you, go back in the middle of the 1980s when he was down in Texas, you mentioned that he introduced John David Green to you. Did he also introduce another friend to you?
Yeah, this other guy that worked for John, his name was Tom, because Mark had lived with him in a 3-bedroom trailer house for a year or so.
Do you remember Tom's last name?
I didn't know it at the time.
Did you learn later?
Yeah.
And who was that?
His last name was Felby.
So this Mr. Felby or Falky worked, Tom Falky worked with your brother and the defendant?
Right.
So I believe you said that around 1988, your brother Mark moved to Florida?
Yes.
Do you know where in Florida he moved?
Someplace close to Ocala.
And did you go visit him?
Yeah.
When you went to visit him, where was he staying?
He was staying in a Winnebago that was belonged to, I believe, John Green. Because John Green and his wife and kids were living in the house there. And the Winnebago was next to the house, pretty close.
So your brother Mark was staying in the Winnebago?
Yes.
On the property owner, Mr. Green?
Right.
To your knowledge, was this your brother working in Florida?
At that time, I don't know if he had been working. I think he had just moved there soon before I came down there to visit.
At some point, did your brother come back to Iowa?
Yeah, in 89, he came back up to Iowa for Christmas.
At some point, did your brother move or buy a home in Iowa?
Yeah, he bought a house in Sac City.
Do you remember in Sac City when he bought the home, about what year were that?
Maybe 97 or somewhere around 97, 98.
To your knowledge, do you know why your brother wanted to buy a home in Sac City?
Well, because he could afford one versus if he were living down in Dallas or Fort Worth, you know, they're a lot less expensive.
To your knowledge, did he have a job when he bought the home in Sac City?
He didn't have a job right away, but he found a job, right, you know, when he went out to look for one.
And throughout this time period we've been talking about, did your family still get together at family events?
Yeah, we'd get together at weddings or family reunions or Christmas or Thanksgiving or whatever.
In 1990, to your knowledge, do you know, did Mark seek some medical help?
Yeah, my mom and dad wanted him to get evaluated up at Cherokee, Iowa.
And after the evaluation in 1990, did you continue to see Mark?
Yes.
Did he act the same after his evaluation as he's always acted with you?
Yeah, he acted like he was, yeah.
And in the 1980s, when you were in Texas, when you would see your brother Mark, did you see him become violent to anybody?
No.
How would you describe Mark then?
Well, he was just hardworking and he kept to himself. And, you know, if the family invited him over for dinner, he'd come over for dinner. And then if my mom and dad came down to visit, they always came over and visited him along with my other brothers and sisters that lived there.
And when you were in Florida, when you saw your brother Mark, did you see him ever become violent to anyone there?
No, I was only there one night. I stayed one night there with him, and then I went on for a vacation.
How about after the evaluation in 1990, and you said your brother bought the home in 1997 or 1998, did you see Mark as well after that?
I was still living out in Idaho, and I came back to Iowa. Anyway, I've never seen him be violent to any of my brothers or sisters or anybody else. He'd argue with them, but...
To your knowledge, when Mark would save money, was he, to your knowledge, would he put the money in a bank or did he keep the money at home?
He usually put the money in his bank.
When your brother Mark bought his house in Sac City in around 1997, 1998, did your brother continue to see your dad?
Yeah, because my parents were both alive. My mom was still alive, so she always invited down for dinner. You know, and we had to have a family get-together. He'd be there for Christmas or Easter or whatever holidays it was.
Did you ever hear anything that Mark told you that he complained about your dad cheating out of some money?
I never heard that from him or any of my other brothers or sisters.
At some point in time, when Mark's living in Sac City, do you know where he had employment?
Well, he's working down at Carroll at Sitel. telemarketer place.
And to your knowledge, did Mark still get involved in trading stock?
Yeah, he'd save up his money and then he'd have to buy on the stocks and see which ones he wanted to buy. And look like something bought it and then hold it and see if he could make some money on it.
You said you've never seen Mark get in any physical altercations with your family members or anybody else?
No.
Would Mark like to argue though?
Yeah, all of us argue.
In 2009, was Mark still living in the home in Sac City?
Yes, he was.
Do you know what type of, did he have a car?
Yeah, he had a little red Geo that he bought from my dad.
Going back to your dad, did Mark and your dad, to your knowledge, did they go fishing together?
Yeah, they went fishing lots of times. I went with them two or three times.
Mr. Koster, now I want to turn your attention to 2009. At some point, were you contacted by someone to go to your brother's house in Sac City?
Yeah, the water company had called up and talked to my dad, but see, he had some slight dementia by then, so he didn't really have any more hearing aids, so he didn't really understand what they were saying, so I talked to him on the phone, and they said that Mark hadn't paid his water bill in a couple months and they've been sending him shut-off notices, so they wanted to know if we could come up, and I said, yeah, I'd come up there. And they said, well, they'll have the police chief up there when we get there.
So did you go to your brother's house in Sac City?
Yeah.
And was the police chief there as well?
Yes, and one of his deputies, I believe.
Did you notice anything different or odd about the outside of the home of your brother's house?
Well, all the shades were closed on the windows and his car was inside the two-car garage, but the garage door was still open.
Did you look in the car to see if anything appeared to be different?
I looked in the car, but I didn't see anything odd. Messy like his house usually does.
Were the keys in the car?
No.
And then was the door locked or open?
Yeah, the three doors to the house were all locked.
Was there a discussion how to enter the home?
Yeah, I told the chief of police that I guess we'll have to kick it in, so side to look to see if Mark could die or,
Before the door was kicked in, was there anything that caught your attention on the door?
Well, there was a note on the back of the door.
And from your memory, do you have any recollection of the note?
Well, I didn't read the note until after we had kicked the door in, and then I noticed that the note was on the door.
When you say a note on the door, describe for the jury, is it on the top of the door, the middle door? What's going on?
Well, it was about in the middle, but he had shades and stuff on the door, so it was kind of hard to see when you first just looked at the door. I just happened to notice it when I closed the door when we left the house.
It was on the outside of the door?
Yeah.
You could see the note and read the note without going in?
Yes.
And what did the note say? To the best of your memory.
Said, to whom it may concern, I went to Florida with Tom, and I'll be back in the spring. And there was a 1-800 number to some resort or something on there.
And at that time, did you contact that number?
Yeah, I called it two times for sure. And they never heard of Tom or a Mark Coster checking in there.
And did you at that time have any idea what it said Tom, who Tom was?
Well, the only Tom I could think of was the Tom that lived down on the Texas and Mark.
And had you been to your brother's home in March or April or May of 2009?
I hadn't been there. I drove by it with my dad because we went up to one of my sister's places up in Minnesota.
Did you notice if anybody had been staying there?
Well, I noticed that there's like a four-door kind of gold brown four-door car with Texas plates on it, but it read the plates. I just seen it was from Texas.
And you didn't recognize the car?
No.
So, okay, we'll go back to you. The police had kicked into the door now in July of 2009. Do you go in the home?
Yeah, they went in first, and then I and Dad went in, and then the guy from the water company went in.
Did you notice anything about the home that seemed out of place?
Well, it was actually clean, which that's not the way Mark had things.
Did you walk through the rooms?
Yeah, I walked through the bedrooms and the bathroom and the living room and the kitchen.
Did you happen to, I guess we described the home for the jury, is how many floors is this home?
It's a single story house with a basement under it.
Did you look in the basement as well?
No, the chief and his deputy that was there, they went down in the basement. There was an air conditioner, and old one was sitting on the door because it was a door that you have to open up. It was dark down there. I didn't have a flashlight. I didn't really want to go down there.
Was there lights in the basement?
I think there's a light switch, but you know, I didn't know that because I've never been in the basement.
So there's you get into the basement, there's steps that go down.
Right.
And then there's a wooden door in this.
Right.
It's a door that goes to the floor.
Yeah.
But there was something on it?
An air conditioner.
An air conditioner that was working or just sitting there?
Well, it looked like it probably didn't work because it was just sitting there.
So a person had to physically move the air conditioner off the...
Yeah, they had to move it off there to go down to the basement.
So what was, after you walked through the house, did you find Mark?
No.
Did you say anything to the police, have any concerns at that time?
Well, I noticed that besides his computer, his ashtray was there and his pipe was in there. And I said, well, if Mark goes anywhere, even if he had left and been three or four miles out of town, he would have came back to get his pipe because he wouldn't leave without his tobacco pipe.
And why would Mark come back for his pipe and just not buy it?
Because he liked to save his money and he was too cheap to go buy another one, so.
So the pipe caught your attention?
Yeah.
And you informed the police about that?
Yes.
May I approach you, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Look, I want to just tell you one thing before, and that is there will be various exhibits that will be introduced in the case, and some of them will be published to you. But you don't have to commit all this to memory. You're going to have the exhibits, for the most part, in your jury room in the time of deliberation, and you'll be able to see them more closely at that time. Go ahead.
Mr. Coster, I'm showing you State's Exhibit Number 1. Do you recognize State's Exhibit Number 1?
Yeah, that's Mark's pipe.
And you said you saw Mark's pipe where?
In the ashtray next to his computer, which was in the living room.
In the living room.
Right.
And his computer, was it on, what was it on?
It was on a little table.
I Did your brother Mark have a lot of furniture in the house?
There was a couple couches and two or three chairs and a few little end tables and his bed and a dresser and stuff like that.
Did you notice anything about was the refrigerator in the house?
Yeah, the refrigerator is old, all that washer dryer, all that.
Was there anything different about the refrigerator when you walked in?
Well, the refrigerator was, the door was open and it had a stick or something prompted open, so I guess it wouldn't smell or whatever.
Was there anything, food or anything?
There wasn't any food in it whatsoever.
So it was cleaned out and a stick was on by the door to keep the door open?
Right.
Did you see anything in the living room or any of the rooms of the main floor when you were walking through? Anything that would indicate there was some type of sign of a struggle or anything?
Not that I could tell.
So after you walked through the house, you noticed that you said law enforcement was there. Did you ask them to do a missing person report?
Not at that time, because there was a possibility that he did go somewhere, but, you know.
So at that time, what did you do with the house? Did you shut the door?
Yes.
And did you tell the police anything about if you would be getting back to him, or how did you leave it?
Well, the door was open, I closed it and everything, and then, you know, because I was driving a truck, so I was, you know, busy making a living too, but we did go back up in there another time, and the chief of police looked around again.
Okay, but I'm right now, for July of 2009, after you go through the house, and you said you didn't do a missing person report at that time?
No.
You shut the door?
Right.
And did you leave it as to see what would happen if Mark would return?
Yeah.
Now, you said a later time you went back. Do you know about when that was there?
Might have been a couple, 2 or 3 months. Because I was going up there and I was needing to get the lawn mowed, so the city don't charge you to mow the lawn.
Would it have been, do you think it's possible it would have been May of the following year?
Well, that's possible when the chief and I may have went back up there after when I was getting ready to file a missing persons report. But I have been up to the house previous to that because I had to get the grass mowed and stuff like that.
I misunderstood you, I apologize. So after July, you would go back to the house to mow the grass?
Right.
And when you would go back to the home, did you see any changes or anything?
No.
And at some point, did you contact your brother Mark's bank to see if they would give you any information?
Yes, because I took all the mail that was in his mailbox, because there was mail in there from the last couple of weeks of May, all of June and July. So I would go up and get his mail like once a month, so I didn't have so much stuff packed in there.
And after checking with the banks, did you learn if there was any bank activity with your brother's account?
There was no bank activity that they could tell me about, because I'd open up his bank statements and there'd be like $2 withdrawal, but that was what the bank charged just to have an ATM card or whatever like that.
So when the mail would come, including your brother's bank statements, you would open them to see if there's any bank activity?
Right.
And was there?
None other than the $2.
So at some point, did you change your mind about doing a missing person report?
Yes, because I figured, you know, unless he brought a lot of money with him and went off and disappeared or something, he'd have to be living on something, you know, if he wasn't taking any money out of his account, you know.
Going back to that, when you were in the house in July of 2009, when you walked through, you noticed Mark's pipe. Did you ever see Mark's wallet?
No, I didn't see a wallet or anything like that.
To your knowledge, was it common for Mark to leave and take a wallet or not take a wallet?
Well, he would have had his wallet cut whenever he was leaving.
So do you remember about when it was when you contacted the police for a missing person?
Probably about May of 2010, because by then it was spring, and, you know, we pretty much knew Mark probably wasn't coming back because we don't think he was alive.
Did you go back to your brother's house?
Yes, I've been up there several times.
And that was a bad question on my part. When you contacted the police chief in May of 2010, did you go to the police station or did you go to Mark's house?
I went to Mark's house.
And did the police chief meet you there?
Yeah.
Did you go into the house one more time?
Yeah, we went in there and looked around again.
Anything different than it had been in July? And then after that, did you fill out a missing person report?
Yes.
And after you filled out the missing person report, later did you take some type of legal action?
Yes, I wanted to get Mark declared deceased, because if you have a bank account and you don't have any activity, deposits or withdrawals, banks have their policies that they can, you know, keep the money or unless they can find next of kin.
And did having Mark declared legally deceased have any impact on his home?
Well, yes, I couldn't get power of attorney because he got to be alive to sign that over, but at least I got legal guardian to be able to do something with it.
And do you remember about when you would have pursued the action to have Mark legally declared deceased?
Maybe 2011.
And is that what happened? Was he declared legally deceased?
Yes. He took the jury like 20 minutes to agree that Mark wasn't around anymore.
So after you had Mark, you said the jury found Mark legally deceased, did that help in getting his home sold and the bank account taken care of?
Yes, that way I could quiet our attorney to do all this, but yeah, we got his bank account closed and then I can legally sell his house or do something with it instead of just paying the property tax on it because it was just deteriorating as time went on.
Were you able to sell the home?
Yes, I did.
Do you remember who you sold it to?
To Gieson.
And do you remember about when you would have sold the home?
2012, I believe.
We'll go back for a second. When you were going to your brother's home, you talked about the pipe you saw, you didn't see his wallet. Did you ever see an umbrella in the house?
No, I've never known Mark to own an umbrella.
Was he the kind of guy that would use an umbrella?
I've never seen him use one.
I don't have any other questions, Jack.
I think we'll pick our morning break at this time.